Okay, you credit.
You're good to go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming on this beautiful Saturday. My name is Chef Cheryl Tate, and I am a proud member of the LA South Chamber of Commerce, of which we have our Hope Foundation of Helping Other People Every Day. That is our nonprofit arm of the LA South Chamber of Commerce. We are the health and wellness team. We are here to present information for you that is going to help other people every day. My name is Chef Cheryl Tate. I am here with Sister Anisa Muhammad, and we're going to address Stress Awareness Month. Okay, April is Stress Awareness Month. Every month there is a subject that we focus on. You know, there's always something. It's also Financial Literacy Month. But in the health and wellness field, we're talking about stress awareness for the month of April. So we're going to make us aware of exactly what stress is. You know, what stress is, what it does to us, how it affects our body. This is a very critical subject that we deal with every single day.
Yes, it is.
Okay. Every single day we are dealing with some stressor of some kind, some minimal stressor or some maximum stressor. And so I have my good sister Anisa Muhammad that is here with me. She is a master of public health, and she has been educating me on some wonderful things, and I have been educating her on some wonderful things. And so we are going to just jump right into this, because this is Stress Awareness Month. We want everyone to be aware of what's going on around us. Okay, so Sister Anisa, I'm going to let you take over, and we are back and forth, and we are informing everyone about stress awareness.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all so much for joining us. Again, I am also a proud card-carrying member of the Los Angeles South Chamber of Commerce, and I love the Hope Foundation, helping other people every day. And today, Saturday, April 23rd, we're helping other people every day by saying, just sharing a little bit with you with regard to stress and how cyclical it can become as it leads to chronic diseases. So we're going to help one another connect the dots, if you will. Okay. So stress is defined as a state of mental or emotional strain or tension resulting from adverse or very demanding circumstances. So that's a very broad definition, right? So what stresses me out may not stress you out. And that's what makes it so broad, but it's not necessarily the stress. It's how we react to it. It's how we decide to deal with it that can possibly get us in trouble with our physical health and a little bit of emotional and imbalance, if you will. So it's very, very dynamic. Stress in part is rooted in the perception of a perceived event. For example, I'm just in a car accident. That's an immediate stress response, right? And then you may hear talk in your job about the possibility of laying people off. That's a stressful event that has not yet occurred, but it can still cause some level of stress in your mind. And once a stressful event has occurred, then your brain responds to this particular type of stress in an emotional way, because stress is all about emotional responses of what it is that you think will happen or something that has already happened. And what happens, the emotional center of your brain is called the amygdala. And when this stressful event occurs or is perceived, then the amygdala will send a signal to your hypothalamus. And that's where all of the trouble starts. The leading causes of stress in the United States, and Cheryl, you're going to have to help me out here because I may not remember all four of them, but okay. I do know that number one is work.
Yes.
We have to work and work and work just to make ends meet. And I'm not saying so that I can live at large and go on cruises. I'm just talking about paying your mortgage or paying your rent and not knowing where your next meal is coming from, because as inflation increases, the size of our pockets decrease. Is that right? I'm a living witness to that, right?
Very true.
Then you have health problems can also increase stress. Sure, what else can increase our stress level today?
Well, you know, this is a really interesting situation, because here we are in this part of Southern California, in this part of the world, and we have sun and fun. We have the beach, we have the mountains and everything, but we live in a metropolis, okay?
Yes.
And we're in a very large city. I mean, Los Angeles is like a destination. So our stressors may be different from somebody, let's say, in a rural part of town. Okay, in a rural part of the state. So one of the things that is really interesting is that there was an article that was just released by UCLA, and it talked about the quality of life in Los Angeles. So there's a lot of things that are stressing us out as far as the quality of life in Los Angeles. And I'll just kind of, pull back the camera a little bit and see just what has happened to us. Just what's happened to us in this particular decade, because we're in 2020 right now. We're in 2022. At the beginning of 2022, we had a pandemic, okay? We had something that said, stop everything you're doing, stop working, you know, pull the kids out of school. Oh my gosh, people are gonna be sick. You know, that was the major stressor of everyone.
Yes, okay.
It affected your job. It affected your family. Your livelihood was changed. Okay. You know, we had an election. Let's not forget about that. That was pretty hot and heavy. You know, people were taking sides, and that was very stressful. I know that part of 2020 was very stressful. Okay. And of course, everyone's finances and everyone's world has been turned upside down. Everyone's has been. So, you know, just like Sister Anissa said, it's what stresses you out. But on this level, everything stresses you out. We can't even go to the smaller things that stress us out, because we have all these big things that are going on.
Yes.
I don't have a job. I can't go to my job. Someone is sick. I can't go around that person. These are really big things. These are really big stressors.
Okay? And you know, and you know, sis, during 2020, family dynamics also shifted.
Yes, they did.
You know, because you had sick family members that you had to stay in the house and take care of because they had COVID. You had the healthcare system. You couldn't go to the doctor, and it seemed like they couldn't get it together enough to help people who had high blood pressure and they needed to get their meds re-prescribed, but they can't because they can't go into the facility because of COVID. So all of these things, and then you have the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid, they changed the rules in the middle of the game. And so what they used to cover in 2019, they're not covering anymore. So it's like, how can I pay for my medication if I can't go to work? If I'm furloughed, if I'm laid off, or if I just got fired or whatever. So the suicide rate increased a lot during this pandemic. And so we're going to talk about this stress and help and try to, you know, I mean, because like you said, we live in Southern California in Los Angeles, and we live in, and now what's stressing people out is that I have to pay more money for gas.
Yes.
It's twice as much to fill up. And that was the money you used to set aside for food.
Right, exactly. So we understand that these stressors, you know, there's such big things that we're dealing with, you know? So we have to almost just to kind of corral them to our health, you know? So I have the next slide here, and it's a natural physical mental reaction to life experiences. Mm-hmm. So did you want to elaborate on that, sister?
Yes, ma'am. Well, just as I stated before, you have all of these things going on in your brain it's the way God created it, because the way we're created, he has a contingency factor built in, but all of this stress kind of knocks everything out. And again, as I stated, the hypothalamus is the command center of the brain and of the body. And so when a perceived stressful event occurs, you may feel like, say, for example, using the scenario or the analogy of the car accident, immediately your respiratory rate goes up. Your heart beats a little bit faster. Your blood pressure may go up. When a person is ill, their blood pressure increases. You have cortisol, which is a hormone that really keeps your body in balance. But when you are looking at life, and as Sister Cheryl stated, we're living in Southern California where all of these stresses are coming at us all of a sudden, usually all at one time, then it puts our brain on overload, because the brain does not have the ability to distinguish whether or not this stress is real, if it's perceived, or if it's imagined. By imagine, I mean you're looking at a movie where there's a lot of violence or whatever. Your brain is going to process that as something that's real because that's what it sees. And as a result of that, your fight or flight mechanism is going to always be there, and it's going to never turn off because that's the way your brain is processing that information. So you're dealing with stress at work. Then you get a phone call saying your child acting up at school. Your blood pressure goes up. You're trying to get in control of things. You just almost missed having an accident by a hair's breadth. That caused your heart rate to increase. You're upset. You get home, and then you want to relax by having a drink. Some people smoke a joint. Some people overeat with a half a gallon of ice cream and a whole pack of Chips Ahoy cookies. And none of, you know, it's not funny, but that's what we do to relieve stress. And a lot of that is social, what do you call that? Acculturation.
Yes, it is.
Mm-hmm. You know, and it's something that we're kind of used to. And then when you come home and there's stress in the house, the children are fighting, you're in an abusive relationship, you're having to walk on eggshells, you have a sick family member, all of these things, it just bombards you. And again, that fight or flight mechanism doesn't cut off. It doesn't turn off. So that's what evolves into what medical professionals call chronic stress. And when you have chronic stress going on, then that's when it starts to damage your organs. That's when the cortisol really kicks in, because cortisol, as I said, is a very important hormone. However, cortisol causes your blood sugar levels to increase. So if you go to the doctor and they tell you that your A1C is out of whack and you're trying to figure out, but why is it at 11? I've been eating the right food. Maybe it's the stress.
Right.
Because that's one question that they do not ask you. When they give you your A1C levels, they just tell you, hey, your A1C is out of control. I'm gonna write you a prescription for some metformin or something, and you need to change your lifestyle, when they have no idea what your lifestyle is. They don't know what you're going through at home, and they don't even ask. And if you volunteer that information, they're gonna disregard it because they think that you're in a state of denial. So that causes even more stress, right?
My goodness.
I mean, when your brain goes through these changes in its activity, you get muscle tension and your stomach gets upset. Some of us have chronic nausea. We have acid reflux as a result of it. Your increased blood pressure can lead to actual heart disease. That's or true. You can have a stroke, right? It decreases your immune function too. Maybe that's one of the contributing factors to why so many people were acquiring COVID. It wasn't that they weren't masking. It wasn't that they were in an unclean environment. Some of it was attributed to actual stress from not being able to go to work, this thing having us, I mean, because COVID had a whole lot of people afraid to go out of the house. And then they was going crazy sitting up in the house all day, because that's something that's very unusual. So it's a plethora of things that can actually cause all of these physical changes within our bodies, right? And with everything physical and within your body, there's always that emotional, that psychological, and that mental aspect that goes along with it as well. And it leads to bad habits.
Yes, sister, that you really made a point there when you talked about the A1C, not knowing that is stressful. Now, see, I just learned something. I really have had healthcare professionals come to me and say, oh, you're pre-diabetic. Knowing I'm not eating sugar, knowing I'm not doing anything to that matter. But yeah, I'm living in a stressful situation. Every day is a stress.
Yes.
I didn't connect the two, that the cortisol had to do with your blood sugar. That's an excellent point we need to drive home, okay? Because I was just thinking that the stress would make you, you know, that the cortisol would make you, well, gain weight, yes, but I didn't know it affected your A1C.
It does.
That part I did not know. I didn't know they were together.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Interesting. So interesting. So, because that is what I'm hearing in advertisement. They're saying, okay, well, let's talk about your cortisol levels, okay? But they're not talking about how to get it down. They're trying to give you a chemical for that. Okay. It didn't just say, well, just go sit under a tree. You know, it didn't say, you know, well, let's look at your stress level.
They don't.
No one's addressing that.
They don't.
That's a clear indication that something might be wrong with this picture. If we're talking about, we have stressors and they're not giving us clear information on how exactly to combat this. This is, you know, this is where I believe this conversation is so important, because we need to talk about the why. You know, the why is so important, especially with the cortisol levels. I'm going to move to this next slide, you know, because again, here are the results of stress. You know, I was experiencing these things, and then they were telling me my A1C was up. Okay. The anxiety and the depression. Okay. Or the insomnia of some kind.
Yes,
you know, they did not connect the two. They're not connecting the two. So that's where it's, and again, here we have increased cortisol levels would contribute to elevated blood sugar. You know, mm-hmm. This part, this section right here, the results of stress, you know, and again, they don't look like symptoms. They don't look like symptoms of stress. Overeating. Oh, okay. Why are you overeating?
Okay. You know what? I'm mad right now. And if I don't eat this bag of Cheetos with this ice cream, see what's going to happen. I'm going to have to smack somebody. That's what's going on in our, I mean, I'm just trying to keep it real and keep it in a language that an audience understands. And sometimes instead of overeating, we'll undereat. And it's kind of like, are you going to eat? Well, I'm not hungry.
Right.
And instead of associating that with stress, then they'll say you have an eating disorder, and things can be, I'm going to say, misdiagnosed, or somebody might miss something because of how and what they're taught or how to address these issues in a clinical setting.
Exactly.
You know, and they, no one actually looks at things from a situational standpoint. Do you find yourself depressed? Have you been depressed over the last 2 weeks? Yes. And the first thing they do is do a PHQ-9, and then they want to refer you to a therapist, but they never asked you, so what's causing your depression?
Okay, so let's back up. What is a PHQ-9? You just said
A PHQ-9 is a test that they give you in a clinical setting where they ask you a series of closed-ended questions. Have you felt depressed over the last 2 weeks? Yes. Have you done this? Blah. You know, and you answer it, and then they score it up. And if you get a certain level, then they will refer you to either a superficial counselor. They might refer you straight to mental health because you got a score over 12. And that may not be what you need. I'm depressed right now because my mom, my dad, and my cousin, they were all killed in a car accident. They don't, you know, they never ask you what causes a depression or why you're depressed. They just go down a checklist, and it's very monotonal in the sense that they're looking at a computer screen. They're checking out things. And I'm not saying that that test is correct or incorrect. I don't say it's good, bad, or indifferent. I'm just saying that no one ever looks at the situational things. They look at the numbers that, and they have to ask these questions because there may be some people out there that have chronic depression, but sometimes that chronic depression is caused because of what they're eating. If you're eating cup of noodles, or you've made Chips Ahoy a food group, or you're constantly eating the wrong type of thing. French fries is not a food group. I eat at McDonald's 4 to 5 days out of the week because I'm too tired to cook for my family.
Exactly.
You know, those types of things, the chemicals that's in those foods, those are all processed foods, and processed foods can cause you health problems in the future. And they make your neurotransmitters, that brain chemical brain activity we were talking about before, it causes your neurotransmitters to misfire. They're supposed to fit together like this, but when they misfire, they miss each other. And when they miss each other, the result is depression. The result is anxiety. And those two things cause it as a chain reaction, because when you're depressed, you sleep.
Yes.
When you're depressed, you have either sleep or insomnia. It's like nothing in the middle. It's either one end of the pole or the other. You overeat or you undereat. I'm asleep all the time or I'm awake all the time. And just all kinds of things. And anything is liable to take you over the edge. And, you know, and we're not even going to talk about those that live in crime-ridden communities where you have a lot of gang activity and your children having to duck bullets on their way to and from school. These things and living in a war zone causes a lot of undue stress. And now that and they're not looking at the causes or the root causes of the stress in our communities. They're just saying they're acknowledging that it exists, but politically they're doing nothing to remove those stressful situations out of our community. So it's up to us. And that's the beauty of the Los Angeles South Chamber of Commerce helping other people every day, because we're going to bring you some information that you may never have ever heard before. And that's why I love it. So, yeah. Right.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. That is very true. I mean, just these things that we're addressing, I believe it's going to have to be up to us. It's going to have to be up to us. And knowing that we have these stressors is why, as a community, we have to, one, address them, and two, go about minimizing them. Okay, just as you know, our chamber is helping other people every day, where we have this health and wellness platform, and another platform we have is definitely the financial awareness. So even these, you know, we can be the umbrella in serving people, and in doing so, we can minimize these physical things, you know, yes, by definitely addressing everyone, you know, on a bigger level. So, you know, the items that contribute to stress and the resulting, you know, diseases are everything that we talked about, just going to McDonald's, you know. A less stressful thing would be to possibly just go get some vegetables and eat them.
It's a lot cheaper.
A lot cheaper too.
It is. You know? It's so a lot cheaper than you think.
It's more of an educating, mm-hmm, and more of, you know, just I sometimes go to the biblical to the biblical saying. Okay, so we have to repent, and all repent means is you're just turning away. It's not something so physical. Oh, it's not something so religious. It just means turning away. You know, so if we can turn away from some of these small things, you know, especially like, you know, like you said, French fries is not a food group. Okay. But yet some people have made it a food group, you know, so, you know, they haven't thought about, you know, what the other things that they could possibly eat, because that right there is satisfying them. And they're not really understanding that it's not satisfying them. It's satisfying a mental situation. It's just a little Band-Aid. It's just a little Band-Aid, you know, to combat these things. But looking at this list, you know, and I'm seeing where you have processed meats are the very first thing, you know, it does seem interesting where, you know, this is like the first thing that's on the list, and it has the most sodium. You know,
oh yeah, I didn't. Oh, it does, doesn't it? I didn't think about that.
Yes, exactly. You know, and we're not even going to talk about red meat, but we're going to just talk about processed meats. Okay, you know, the salami, and you know, even though they're wonderful to eat, I find that's something that the nitrates in the meat are something that we crave. Okay,
that's that because chemical that I was talking about, and us becoming addicted to the chemicals that's in the food without us realizing it.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And someone was telling me once that now, because I know we've had this conversation, that Cinnamon Toast Crunch was one of your favorite cereals. Okay. And yes, someone ma'am. Revealed to me not long ago that Cinnamon Toast Crunch had trisodium phosphate in it. You know, I don't know if anybody knows what trisodium phosphate, but when we were kids, it was called TSP. And TSP is what we used to clean the walls with.
Come okay? on, say it, tell them.
So, you know, just mm-hmm. to think about someone giving me that analogy and telling me that what was in the cereal, I said, wait a minute, I know somebody who likes that cereal, okay?
So I used to eat it. That was my favorite cereal.
Exactly. You know, so, you know
we have at to, one time, yes.
Exactly. So just in knowing these things and what that are in the food, you know, just will really help us, you know, get a wrap our brain around what is good for us. So even refined sugar, pardon me, in high fructose corn syrup. Now these two ingredients right here really wreak havoc in our foods, because it's usually in everything. It's usually in everything. If you're not eating anything raw or something that you have prepared yourself, more than likely is going to have high fructose corn syrup. More than likely, okay? I'm being a chef. I'm always in the store, pardon me, looking at and reading food labels. And these are the first things that I come across when I'm reading food labels. So I know, you know, when I'm cooking for my client, this isn't something that I need. I have to go and, you know, and get the raw version or start from scratch. And the ready to eat meals are just have so much sodium in it, just like the processed meats are really, even though it may be convenient, you know, we need to look at the sodium level, because the salt is definitely a food that it's a substance that if we get too much of it, it adds to the stressor.
Can I say something?
It adds to the stressor. You know, the fried foods, the trans fat foods, even frozen desserts, sugar, everything that's on this list adds to the stressor.
Come on, it does.
Adds to the stressor, you know, of what it is that we're already dealing with. So, you know, and we didn't even, you know, look at the alcoholic beverages, because again, the alcohol is going to turn to sugar. And the sugar is going, it is, and there's sugar already in the alcoholic beverage. So I always look at alcohol as it being just a double down as far as, because you have the alcohol that turns to sugar and you have the sugar that's already in the alcohol. And that's where really chemically the hangover comes from, because your body is just processing all this sugar, you know, and your liver is working twice as much. You know what I'm saying? So again, that is a stressor. You know, and again, we have the digestive problems, the diabetes, the high blood pressure. We would think it's from our diet. No, it's not necessarily from our diet. It's from our stressors. It's from the A1C that, you know, that we're talking about, that we're not knowing spikes our blood sugar. There's a lot of commercials out that I'm paying attention to about lowering your A1C. No one ever said just go sit under a tree, okay? No one said, you know, let's go get a bottle of water and maybe let's, you know, go to the park and maybe do our homework there, or maybe, you know, just take the kids and let them run and, you know, and take a bottle of water. No one said that. You know, no one has given that suggestion. Okay, as to how we can lower our stress levels. You know, it's just, it doesn't take a lot, but if we're in constant situations where we are subjected to this, then we have to learn that that's something that we need to change. We definitely need to change how we deal with stress and how we allow ourselves to be subjected to it. You know, there is something that is called, no, I don't want to hear that today. You know, let's go to the park. And one of the things that I have found in life right now, because we are in 2022, we are in an interesting decade right now. This is something that I am starting to see more of, but I did not see prior to, and that was really because people weren't coming out, was that people just come to the park. Because at one point, the park was closed. At one point, the park, you had to wear a mask. You know, because I've been out there. I've been out there for 2 years. I really haven't changed my lifestyle since COVID. Of course, I've been distancing and, of course, vaccinations and what have you. But still, I'm out there seeing the people. And what I'm seeing now is more people are coming out. They're going to the park. They're taking their children. They're letting them run and jump and play and bump like they used to before all this happened. And so I see that is really, as I'm watching these people, because I'm watching these people from a distance, I'm watching how the children are interacting with each other, how the children are interacting with their parents. They're happy to be outside. So it's definitely circumstances. We have to create those circumstances to where we can lower our stress level, because we can do it. It's not, you know, us as we understand what is good for us. And what is good for us may not be being inside, okay? All these restrictions have lifted now. It seems like we had a pandemic, but now we have the remnants of something that was very, confining. I think that would be the correct word, very confining. So now that we have the remnants of it, it's still a stressful situation. Because as we know, we're still in a pandemic.
Yes,
we are still in a pandemic.
Yes,
okay. But it's just the idea that there's some control over what's going on. Okay. Not once have they said, oh gosh, we're in a pandemic. Maybe you should work on your immune system.
You know, Cheryl, that's a very, very good point, because it seemed as if whenever someone brought up the topic, and this is your profession, let's cook up something that's healthy for you that can help build your immune system.
Exactly.
They came at you like you were, and that was a crime seemingly punishable by death for you to even mention talking about cooking food or eating food that can help boost your immunity, because when you're under stress, it compromises your immune system. It compromises your fluid and electrolytes, which is what your body needs on a cellular level so that your body's cells can do what they're supposed to do. And it interferes with nutrient absorption. So a lot of us are malnourished.
Right.
Which, and you know, the after effects of which causes your organs to have to work overtime. So because those organs and those body systems are working overtime, it creates stress within the body, and it creates chronic diseases. And like you said, again and again, nobody's addressing these things. They're not talking about it. And those commercials you were talking about, they're not saying go sit under the tree. They say, here, take this pill right here three times a day, and oh, we can help you with that. But they never tell you that taking all those pills over time would ruin your kidneys and your liver.
Yes, very much so.
They
very
don't.
Much so.
They
and, don't. And the interesting thing is there's more than one commercial for this, okay? Oh, you want to put your A1C down? Oh, you can do this. Again, we're not addressing. We're not addressing. So here is just a small list of things that we could eat to help relieve. Just this is small, okay? But it's something that we can definitely follow and definitely build upon. Okay.
Yes.
So the reason why I chose these, you know, I'm always researching and seeing what, you know, what other people are saying, as opposed to what I'm already doing myself, you know. And what I have found in my research is that I cook all these foods. This is kind of like the standards, my standard menu for my clients. Okay. Because we are going to put bell peppers in our food, okay? And turkey being, you know, we can really start just with bell peppers. Bell peppers are very high, you know, just the red color speaks to us.
Okay? Yes.
And red bell peppers have the highest nutrients. And, you know, anytime your body is getting more nutrients, it's fighting off whatever it is it's supposed to be doing. It's fighting off those stressors, all those things that are coming at us, okay? So one of the things, and I thought this was really, this was not comical, but just really interesting, because turkey has a chemical called tryptophan. Mm-hmm. And if we all know Thanksgiving, you know, after you have that Thanksgiving meal, everybody's ready to go sit down and watch the game, okay? And it's that tryptophan in it that is more like a relaxer. It just relaxes you, you know? So yes, it does fight stress, okay? If you have a turkey sandwich, you will be feeling better, okay?
You're funny.
Not gonna run and jump and, you know, and maybe be stressed out. A turkey sandwich, you know, does go a long way because the chemicals in the turkey is called, they're called tryptophan. So just always, I always take it back to Thanksgiving. After you're done with that Thanksgiving dinner, everybody's sitting down, everybody's come, nobody's too stressed out that day, okay? So another is just greens in particular. And spinach was one of the greens that was mentioned, but in another article, I found collard greens. Now, collard greens, all greens are full of magnesium, okay? And magnesium is such a, it's a nutrient rich ingredient that we need in ourselves, and it helps us fight stress. If we have a diet rich in magnesium, it definitely combats it. Avocados is another green vegetable fruit, really, that combats stress because of its chemical makeup. It's so rich in magnesium, okay? And tea is awesome. Just green tea, any kind of tea is really good for your system because it definitely has those antioxidants where they fight your stress. And oranges are just excellent for your immune system. Oranges, period. Anything that orange juice, orange slices, the vitamin C is really good for fighting your immune system. And if your immune system is up, you know, if you have a very good immune system, you're fighting your stress. You're fighting stress because you it's almost like your immune system. I cannot express how important your immune system is. We can talk about stress and we can talk about eating healthy, but if you don't have a good immune system, it's almost like that's the thing that's going out there working for you. That's your combat gear. You know, that's what really protects you. It is literally like a force field. Because if you're eating all the correct foods, if you're lowering your stress level, if you're conscious of what's going on, that's a combatant right there, because you're girding yourself for whatever it is that the world is, you know, what the world hurls at us, okay? And a lot is thrown at us, especially us as people of color. We have to understand that, you know, it's not an imagination that we go through what we go through, and that we go through things different from other cultures. We have to understand that. So we have to treat our stressors differently from other stressors. There's more of it. We need to understand that. There's more stressors than other cultures. So we need to be more understanding of that and addressing it with each other.
And
because
you know,
if we're not understanding it and saying, hey, just like we're doing right now, listen, we're in a stressful situation. This is what's going on in the world. you know. And look, I have to be the first one to say, because, you know, just being in webinars when you're online on Facebook Live is stressful, okay? It's stressful, but we get through this, just like we understand these are stressors, some stressors that are good and some stressors that are bad.
You know, Cheryl, the foods that you mentioned, especially the fruits and vegetables,
exactly,
they are so awesome in keeping that chemical balance, that state of homeostasis within our body. But we have to also be mindful of cooking it too long so that all of the nutrients are gone, smothering it in ketchup or smothering it in butter and things that are like margarine, for example, that's trans fatty acid.
Exactly.
And it defeats the purpose of you eating those collard greens or that broccoli or bananas or whatever it is that you're having. And in addition to that, we have stress can cause digestive system issues with your stomach. Mm-hmm. And so cottage cheese and cream cheese and yogurt are really good for that. And eat lentils, because proteins help protect the cells. Those amino acids protect the cells and keep the dangerous things from getting in. It's like lentils and navy beans and eggs, but not too many, because that might raise your cholesterol levels.
That's very true.
And smothering those delicious natural strawberries and berries, which are antioxidants, smothering them with quote unquote fake cream and sugar is defeating the purpose of having those beautiful berries on your plate. So make sure you're mindful of your sugar intake. Caffeine may relax you, but it's temporary. It's very temporary, because after you come down, that caffeine might have you like this, especially if you go to different places where the coffee is stronger than others. And like you mentioned about the alcohol is a depressant anyway.
Right.
It's categorized as a depressant. So, and stay away from cookies and cakes and pies, especially if they're store-bought. If you gotta have them, go in the kitchen and make them like Big Mama used to make, but just don't eat them all at one time.
Very much so. We always, you know, we have really, and I just have to bring this up as being another stressor. We have something called social media, okay? Ooh, and yes, it is something that people spend some time on, okay? It can be very stressful to watch those things and to see the situations that are going on, because like you were saying, your brain doesn't know whether it's true or not. You know, your brain doesn't pick up whether that situation is real or not. So if you're looking at social media and you're looking at situations that are going on, some good, some not always good, you know, your brain is regulating that, oh, this is what's going, like you said, sister, you know, that's what's going on in your life, when it really isn't, you know. And we have to understand that that's something that we could curb, okay? And that would definitely help in the stress level, okay? Mm-hmm. You know, it's okay. Maybe I tend to talk about relaxing and doing nothing and keeping a journal and maybe sleeping, you know, understanding that it will affect your sleep patterns, that you are aware of these things, or that you even make it a mental note, because you said either you're insomnia, either you're not sleeping or you're sleeping, you know, to make it a point to try to regulate that if you see that it's a pattern. Mm-hmm. If you see that it's a pattern, well, I'm sleeping too much. Well, maybe I need to get up and do something other than sleeping, okay? I'm sleeping too much. Why is that, okay? Let me write that down in my journal. Why am I sleeping too much? What's going on in my life? Wow, you know that YouTube video about those people fighting, and, you know, we'll leave the culture part out about people getting slapped and stuff, but that is something, no, but seriously, but that is something, it was a stressful situation, because we tend to when we see things that are going on in life, we as a culture tend to we tend to own them. Okay, so when we own when we own these activities and when we own these attitudes and what it is we say, it's stressful. You know, we're saying, oh my gosh, why did that person slap that person? Or why did this happen in the first place? And we all know it was a stressful situation that led to that. So, you know, all these factors that we bring into the situation, along with just the everyday of what's going on, you know, gives us a lot to pay attention to. It gives us a lot to consider when we're thinking about what stresses us. So I would like to say that, you know, this is a lot of information, but at the same token, we can bring it in and say, how does it help me? What is affecting me? And how can I look at all these things, all these different modalities of what's been happening to us? You know, the anxiety, the depression, the increased heart rate, the cortisol, the substance abuse. We have to, in some way, own the situation. You know, own, okay, this is what I'm doing. How can I do better? What can I do that can turn a corner? I can talk to you. I can talk to my sister. I can talk to someone, you know. All this information that we have, we looked for, even though we find that it's easily in front of us, but at the same token, we're not really acknowledging.
Sure, you know, we're not acknowledging. I want to share just a little brief story, if I may. And leave this slide up, because I know that just like you said, when you notice that you've been sleeping a lot.
Right.
I noticed that, and I went to, there was a time in my life where I would sleep for 10 or 12 hours, and 5 minutes after I'm up, I want to go back to bed again.
Right.
And I was told that I was clinically depressed, and I was self-medicating at that time because of what was stressing me out was in my house.
I see.
Mm-hmm. And it was environmental. And I overate, but it was always the wrong food. So I can hit every last one of these points. And in addition to that, there was the consequences helped my health status to deteriorate. And the doctors wanted to give me 3-4 different types of antidepressant medications. And in that second, the light bulb in my brain turned on, and I said, you know what? Okay, thank you. I just took the prescription, and when I got outside, I tore it up because mm-hmm. I knew that I wasn't going to do that. Why would I take something that I knew that God can help me get out of that? Because I looked at that as a slap in the face to God. He helped me. My faith helped me to overcome that. And the first thing I had to do was clean house and separate myself from what was stressing me out, because sometimes it's not what we do, it's who we do that can create excess stress in our environment and therefore in our minds, our emotions, all of that. And over time, I stopped eating the wrong food and started eating to live. And the chemical balance came back in my brain. It came back in my body. And now I have my health restored and I'm not stressed out anymore. Why? Because I had to learn, but I had to learn the hard way how to overcome this stress. And so now those same things would come or would try to come in my atmosphere, but it's kind of like that force field that you talked about.
Exactly.
It's not, and it's about how I handle it. I'm not handle it anymore. I don't self-medicate. I don't have to. I don't overeat. I eat what I'm supposed to. And yes, every now and then I might eat some cookies or something like that. I'm not going to lie, but it's not that I sit there and make a whole food group and a meal out of just cookies and some kind of Kool-Aid or something. I don't do that. Right. That's so we have to take control. Exactly. We have to acknowledge what's going on and say, you know what, like you said, repentance, meaning you have to turn away from what's causing you the pain, which is subsequently causing you the stress, which is subsequently causing you to do all these irrational things, just so that you can feel good temporarily.
Yes, that is so true. That is so true. You know, as much as that we have these these modalities that are against us, you know, it doesn't take much. It just takes an effort on our part to say what it is we will and we won't do. You know, it comes back to responsibility. Yes. Responsibility is with everything that's going on in our society. We can and we are taking responsibility and saying, this is something we can address. This is something we can address, but we don't have to right now because we know that it's over there. Okay. So, meaning that, we know that we have a stressor of how we eat bad. Okay, mm-hmm. So I can say, all right, let me go take my, I'm just going to go and be real. Let me go take my EBT card and go to the grocery store and say, I'm going to use my funds for this, going into the grocery section and buying the fresh vegetables and staying in the perimeter of the grocery store and in the frozen section or in the produce section and staying away from the middle of the store where you have boxed foods, where you have processed foods, where, you know, there's going to be products that will have more salt because they are packaged, you know, and it was always the psychology of when we were taught. And this was before I even became a chef. They would always hear, shop the perimeter of the store because that's where the better food is. Okay. Because when you walk in the store, usually what are you going to? You're going to the produce section. Okay. When you're walking in the perimeter of the store, where are you going to? You're going to the refrigeration, the dairy, and then you're going to come around to the meat department. So you know, I've been in a lot of grocery stores. I know their makeup. So you psychologically can go through the grocery store and make good choices if you just know where to go, okay? You're not going in the sugar aisle. You're not going in the canned food aisle because there is a canned vegetable aisle. There is one, okay? But right next to that canned vegetable aisle is the produce aisle. So that is where we can definitely make better choices. And definitely help with our diets. Yes, so ma'am. I wanted to give this section here for references because all of this information that we have talked about, you know, it's not just coming from the top of our heads. Stress is real. You know, the Cleveland Clinic has done studies on it, just like the article that we talked about earlier about the quality of life in our city. You know, the information that I have gleaned from, that I have brought here, is from the American Institute of Stress. Okay, they have edifices to talk about stress. We have buildings here that are going to talk about your stress, okay? But yet, we're not, again, we're identifying it, but we're not necessarily doing anything about it. Yes, these websites will give you information about how to go about it, but it's just interesting. I'm just going to give this little bitty caveat. It's interesting how we can go about it, but nobody's really trying to fix the situation. I don't really see that happening. They're doing a great job of telling you what you should, what you need to look out for, how this is happening, but no one's saying, oh, okay, we don't need all this information. Go outside and go love your kids, okay? Go outside and go love your kids, okay? will take away, you know, you not being able to have money. You know, here's your good job. Here's what it is you should have. Go love your kids. Okay. This is not difficult, but at the same time, it's something that we can definitely add on and definitely work from. We are having this conversation is definitely something that we are continuing to have. So this is what we will be doing. Can I see my screen sharing? Can everyone see my screen here?
So, yes, ma'am.
So this is what we will be doing as a continuum of this conversation. Is we will be having on Thursday, the 28th of April, we're going to be continuing with the Chef and with Cheryl show, where we're going to talk about, you know, we're going to bring some foods, and Sister Anissa are going to talk about Stress Awareness Month, understanding the connection between how you feel and the food that you eat. And definitely foods that will combat your stress. We'll bring out some greens and some tea and some avocado and definitely different foods that combat stress. And definitely we're going to expound more on how to live stress-free. All the things that we, you know, that we've talked about, really just taking life into our hands, taking being more responsible of what it is that we're doing in our lives and making it more stress-free. So I would invite everyone that's here to please meet us Thursday at 11 a.m. on this channel, our LA South Hope Foundation, our LA South Chamber of Commerce YouTube channel, where we're going to continue this conversation. This is really, really important. Stress awareness is something that we should be talking about every single day, not necessarily the month of April, okay? And so this, you know, this is one of my little stress alleviators is my cat, okay? This, you know, he is the person that, you know, he's purring here. So, but everyone has their own way of, you know, combating stress, you know? And I'm being a culinarian, being a creative person. I always have something creative. So it's a cat, it's a cat that helps me, you know? But this is really, everyone has their own way of dealing with stress. But I hope in some way we have educated you, or at least brought you into understanding of, yes, we live in a stressful environment. And we are just here to help everyone with everything that we're doing here. We appreciate you. This is the LA South Chamber of Commerce. And this is our Hope Foundation. This is our webinar has been on Stress Awareness Month. We are so happy that you have come. We are honored and privileged that you have come. And we hope that you have learned something. And we look forward to seeing you Thursday at 11 o'clock, where we'll be continuing on the Chefing with Cheryl show. So I thank you so much. And please be well in that time that we meet again.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Again. Thank you. All right.
Thank you so much. Mm-hmm.